murder wise. Grass only greener when it's fertilized. Gave them truth in these songs, they prefer the lies. Destiny beautiful, adrift in her purple lies.
Before we get started,
it only takes two clicks to become one of Earth's mightiest subscribers. Click. Click.
What's up, Earth's Mightiest Subscribers? I just want to let you know about a really awesome deal you can get at BeautifulHalo.com, where you can pick up awesome Marvel Comics merch, DC Comics merch. All you gotta do is go check out the link in the description and find out how you can get an awesome deal at Beautiful Halo.
What is up, Earth's Mightiest Subscribers? It's Ernie Blur Without Fear. Welcome back to the channel. So I seem to have this problem with taking on Herculean task. Like I always say, oh, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna cover that. And you know, I come to find that I have taken on yet another Herculean task in the form of House of X and Powers of 10. And today, we are talking about these bi-weekly series, because you know, one comes out one week, the other one comes out another week, but both comics actually only come out every 2 weeks. So that's why I'm saying technically it is a weekly title, but because there are two separate titles, bi-weekly. Once again, I've got notes, 9 pages worth of notes on this little notepad for Jonathan Hickman and R.B. Silva's Powers of 10, number one. And yes, I know the title reads Powers of X. And I feel like I say this all the time, but Jonathan Hickman has said is actually Powers of 10. And by the time we get to the end of the series, you will know why. Anyways, what this book does is that it plays with the history that we know about the X-Men, not just in the form of the past history, but also plays with what we know about the future of mutant kind in the Marvel Universe. This book jumps around from different periods, from what they call year zero, which is the dream where we see Charles Xavier, to what we also would later see as year 10, year 100, and year 1000. This one is really cool because there's a particular part here I'm not gonna spend a whole lot of time on because I don't feel like there's a lot there, at least not yet. But there is a point when we see Moya McTaggart, who I think a lot of people kind of wondered who this character was. Was it Moya? Was it Kitty? You know, who the hell was it? But at the end of the day, it is Moya McTaggart, and she finds Charles Xavier during year zero. He is pretty much chilling at this festival, this carnival of sorts, basically just trying to take a load off. And when Moya is talking to him, she speaks to him as someone who, you know, is a stranger, but at the same time, she also speaks to him in a very familiar way. She even knows his name, much to the surprise of Charles Xavier, because he has no clue who this woman is. But what winds up happening out of this, and this is actually this was tweeted by Jonathan Hickman, where he showed this particular panel I'm showing right now, where he said this is going to be one of the most important, or maybe even the most important set of panels, the most important page in X-Men history. And this is preceded by, you know, her talking to Charles about the dream, Charles's dream about human and, you know, mutant kind, just, you know, standing side by side together as one, not as enemies, but as equals. And Moya states that it's not a dream if it's real. And then we see this panel where basically, you know, Charles wants to know who she is. How does she know his name? And she tells him to read her mind. And when he does, we don't necessarily see the sum total of what it is he learns, but he sees something and it surprises him. Another thing I thought was really interesting, and this is just because of how weird comics publication is, like timelines and things like that. And I don't know, maybe there's more going on here than maybe I even realize. But I will say that there is a point where we get to see year 10. And year 10 is exactly the point that we're at now with House of X number one. In this, we learn that yes, by the time Charles Xavier had founded Krakoa as the new mutant nation, it had been 10 years, which is really weird when you think about it, comics publication-wise. The X-Men debuted back in 1963, and granted, I mean, at the time they were created, I mean, yeah, it was theoretically that time frame, at least that's what you would assume, that it was the present as it was then. And I guess it's safe to say we are in 2019, in the year of our Lord of the Rings. So that said, it makes you wonder, like, wow, are they doing some weird thing where they're playing with how much time has passed in, you know, the course of Marvel Comics? Which, I mean, that would make sense, because otherwise most of these heroes would be in the retirement home. Comic book timelines are weird. But that said, we still don't know what it was that Mystique stole from Damage Control. I mean, we know that it's secrets, it's information, it's something, and it probably has to do with that grocery list of things that Damage Control has in their possession that we learned through House of X number one. I didn't touch on that in the last book because it just didn't seem like it was ready for a big reveal yet. But now we know maybe that's what they were after. But what we do know is who sent Mystique, Toad, and Sabretooth to go track down this information, and it was none other than Magneto and Charles Xavier. Which, I know in the last video I did talk about the fact that I think that this is not actually Charles Xavier, that it's probably, like, I know some people have talked about, oh, the maker of this, the maker of that, and I did think the same thing. It was the first thing that crossed my mind when I first saw the solicits for House of X and Powers of Ten. However, I don't know if that's actually the case. I think it's just a coincidence because everyone kind of seems to treat him like Charles Xavier. But the thing that's really telling here is they're talking about building a better world. You know, what are you willing to do for mutant kind to help your fellow mutant? Because this is a question that both Mystique and Charles posed to one another in the exchanging of the information that was taken from Damage Control. And one of the parts I actually thought was really telling about Charles is that there's a point where he tells Mystique, when she, you know, gives him the same question about helping mutant kind, and he simply replies that for building a better world, everyone who would live in it owes something. And basically just kind of goes back to that mentality that, you know, yeah, you know, we're used to the passive Charles. We're used to the more, you know, anti-war Charles. We're not used to this, you know, Charles who is a full measure man. He's usually a man of half measure. And now it seems like he's changed that attitude. This actually sounds more like a Magneto way of thinking, if I'm being brutally honest. But I mean, you know, hey, you tell me. And that's pretty much all we really get out of year 10. Everything else is going to take place in this book is pretty much all from year 100. To year 1000. Yeah, just sit tight, because this is only, literally, this was the first of 9 pages of notes that I wrote. So, on to page 2 of my notes. What we're talking about here is that we now know that based on Powers of 10 number 1, we know that, you know, we learned in House of X number 1 that humanity is doomed to go extinct in 20 years, and that mutant kind will become the dominant species on planet Earth. Well, now we know. We also know that there was an organization called the Orcus Protocol who is trying to stop that from happening. Well, as of Powers of 10 number 1, we now know that didn't happen. Mutantkind is not the dominant species on planet Earth 100 years from House of X number 1. Could we learn that this coalition, this empire, which I've seen go by more than a couple of different names in just this book alone, depending on who is talking about them. They are usually referred to as the Man-Machine Supremacy or the Man-Machine Ascendancy, and I've even seen them referred to as the Human-Machine Empire or Monolith or some other random word that sounds really good if you were into wrestling factions like the McMahon-Helmsley regime. Basically, what's going on here, it seems that humankind, maybe this is what Orcus was going after all along, because they did seem to throw in their lot with Omega Sentinel, and they also seem to be really relying on technology and, you know, the Sentinel master mold for you know, everything that they were using to try to thwart off humanity's own extinction. But man, it is just crazy, because now mutants are being tracked down and hunted by these human machine hybrids. And we know that there is a resistance force that is in play, and these are some new characters. These are characters we actually saw teased on all of the advertising for House of X and Powers of 10. The character with blue skin, the woman who everyone was like, oh, who is this new character? She seems to have a lot of powers. What's this all about? And then the other character, who was this man in red, who I actually originally thought might have been Azazel, but it was like, no, that's not Azazel at all. This is somebody else. And now we know who these characters are. We know that the woman, the blue-skinned woman, is a woman by the name of Rasputin. And we also know that the man in red is a mutant by the name of Cardinal. We also know that they have other mutants with them, like Percival and another one named Silabel, but they're not long for this Earth. We're just gonna go ahead and say that right now. Basically, what you need to know is that these mutants are a part of what they call the Sinister Line. It's this really weird thing, and I'm gonna have to get my notes for this because there's a lot of information to disseminate right here, so I apologize. I normally like to be a little better prepared than this, but There's a lot in this book. Basically, what you need to know is that the Sinister line is very similar and actually kind of runs parallel to the Hound program that Ahab was a very strong proponent of. But instead of genetically crossbreeding and modifying and creating new mutants for hunting and infiltration, what they did is they created weapons. Weapons of outright war. And this was something that was all spearheaded by Mr. Sinister, as the name Sinister line would imply. Now, I didn't understand this the first two or three times I read this, and I don't even really fully understand it now, but I'm not sure if they're referring to House of M or maybe another mutant birth crisis that happened post-Krakoa. But basically, this led to a fluctuation in the leadership, whether through death or disappearance, and it led to some questionable decisions being made, namely putting Sinister in charge of revitalizing mutant birth rates. Anyways, what I'm trying to tell you is that these mutants that I'm talking about here, Rasputin and Cardinal Percival, they are what is referred to as chimeras. They're descendants of first generation mutants who were genetically created. And they were engineered to act as super soldiers and guardians of Krakoa, a fighting force built to thwart off any potential invasion, any potential threat, whatever they needed. And at this particular moment, we learned that Krakoa, I mean, it's brand new to us right now, but apparently it lasts for the next 30 years. Now, the mutants I was just talking about, Rasputin, Cardinal, and so on, these are fourth generation chimeras, whereby at this point, by the fourth generation, instead of using one or two different X genes to create a super soldier, Sinister began using multiple ones, upwards of four and five different mutant X genes, to create more Omega level mutants. Now, we also learned that this kind of led to the downfall of Krakoa, because as they kept making more and more and more of these, you know, chimeras, there became this fail rate where at each generation the fail rate increased. Where at first the fail rates would be under 1% in the first generation, but by the time you get to the second and third generation, fail rates had increased from as much as 1% to almost 10%. And by the time you get to generation 4, the fail rate had exponentially driven up to over 60%. And what I mean by fail rate is that these mutants were genetically modified to be warriors. They were meant to be aggressive. They were meant to want to fight. But what happened is that these particular mutants, they didn't want that. They often were born with power sets that weren't even suited to, you know, war per se. They were referred to as having peacetime powers, and they were often pacifists, mostly becoming obsessed with religion and also no longer wanting to claim any form of individuality or individual name. They all took on the name of Cardinal, so that's exactly what Cardinal is. Cardinal is one of the failed fourth generation chimeras. Whereas Rasputin, on the other hand, Rasputin is on the, I guess, success rate variety. And we actually get a breakdown of what her genetic makeup is, where she has the DNA of Kid Omega using his telepathic X gene. Gotta remember, Kid Omega is an Omega level mutant. She also has Colossus's metal metamorphosis. She has Eunice the Untouchable's force field generation capability. She also has Kitty Pryde's intangibility gene. And she has X-23's healing factor. Now, one thing we learned is that, unsurprisingly, Mr. Sinister pretty much did what Mr. Sinister does. He betrayed Krakoa, and more importantly, the Sinister line that he created. These fail rates were on purpose. He actually set these in motion. This was all by design. Now, as Mr. Sinister is wont to do, of course, Mr. Sinister is going to betray the people he's working with. Of course he is, because Mr. Sinister. But we do know that he did get some comeuppance when the Man-Machine Ascendancy, or Supremacy, whichever you want to call them, publicly executed him once they caught up with him after he had defected from Krakoa.
And to make a long story short, too late!
We see Rasputin risk life and limb to try and save Silabelle from the hunters who have captured her, and it is in vain. It's an effort that is largely in vain, but we do get to see a lot of Rasputin's power set. She even seems to possess a sword that is not too dissimilar from Magic's own sword, which is, yeah, it's interesting. It's a very interesting kind of power set and skill set that she has. I mean, it's anyways, Silabelle is captured by these hunters and taken back to the human machine monolith. which is basically the seat of power for the man-machine supremacy. So, which once again is something I kind of originally associated with Orcus from House of X number one. But one of the things I thought that really stuck out to me is the character of Nimrod in this. Sitting on this throne of power is Nimrod, and by his side is Omega Sentinel. So it makes me wonder, what is up exactly, you know, with this whole deal? Because you gotta, if you go back to the very first page of this book, of Powers of 10 number one, you go back to the first page shows us all the different points in history, and it all kind of seems like it's from Charles Xavier's perspective. We see Xavier at year zero. We see him yet again at year 10. And then while we get to year 100, we see Nimrod instead of Charles Xavier. And we even see another face afterward at year 1000, but we don't know who that is just yet. I will get to that here in a minute. But it begs the question, did Orcus become something else in their pursuit to try and stave off humanity's extinction? We know that clearly they decided to make a bond between man and machine to try and prolong human life. But did they at some point, did Omega Sentinel betray them, as I kind of suspected was the case? Was she acting as a double agent? Or at some point, did the mission change? Did something happen? Like, we don't really have the answers yet to support any theories or claims at this point. But it's just something I'm like, okay, wow, I can't wait to see how this unfolds. Another thing I think is very interesting to point out is that Nimrod, which I think is a first for, you know, this type of character, is not an unpleasant person. Nani? Yes, now of course he is a future version of a Sentinel, and Sentinels are made to hunt and track down mutants and kill them, or subjugate them, whichever comes first. But no, this particular Nimrod is really polite. He even apologizes to Silabelle when he finds out that she is one of the last remnants of one of the kennels that was used to house and create hounds, because she is herself a hound, the one of the last ones created by the man-machine supremacy. It's really weird, but this particular version of Nimrod, he seems incredibly more humane than any version of a Sentinel or Nimrod has ever even seemed before. He even seems happy that her and the other mutants that were hounds rebelled against them and rose up and defected back to the mutants of Krakoa, or what used to be Krakoa by this point. He even goes on to say that all bad ideas deserve to die a bad death, and he is not the least bit sad about the fact that she rebelled. He is happy for her. He even congratulates her on so much. He even seems perfectly okay with the fact that she stands defiant against him when he asks for the information that, you know, he's presuming that she stole. That said, Omega and Nimrod are pretty much willing to do whatever it takes to get the information, or at least rather, the idea of whatever information she may or may not have stolen from her by any means necessary. They have no qualms about that at all. But Silabelle, because of her hound training and because she is one of the generations that came out of, I believe it was called Sal Sin or something like that, kennel, she basically has what they call a black brain. She cannot be tortured. She cannot be manipulated into giving up information. So pretty much anything they're gonna do, regardless of how painful or excruciating it might be, she's not gonna give it up. But Nimrod actually has an idea that'll work, and he is oddly anime levels of chipper about it. Essentially, it's a device that would break Silabelle down into a liquidated form, essentially turning her into femto fluid, and eventually distill her down into data that will be curated, you know, at some later point. Something that we learn is still technically happening 1,000 years later. When we're introduced to a new character who we know is the librarian, and he is the character we saw at the very beginning that, you know, kind of looks like Charles Xavier. We don't know if it is Charles Xavier or if it's somebody else. Like I said, it's just, it's batshit insane, and it makes me wonder, is Charles, is some piece of Charles inside that Nimrod? Is this alien, whatever it is, mutant, whatever, is this also Charles? We don't know. We don't have the answers. We don't have any definitive proof yet. But basically, this character librarian is curating all of this knowledge that was distilled the way Nimrod did Silabelle. And a newer version, a more updated version of Nimrod, is helping him and seems to be repentant about what he did to Silabelle and the other mutants, like, you know, curating them this way. But Librarian seems to be of the belief that, yes, you were programmed to do a certain thing, but you're not doing that thing anymore. You're trying to do something different. And what they've done is they've created this collective mutant consciousness. But the problem is that mutant consciousness is starting to die, and they're trying to, I presume, figure out a way to save it. Basically, everything that was done here were things that were done during the Human-Mutant War that essentially amounted to pointless efforts in a pointless war that should never have been fought in the first place. That's kind of where I think a lot of Jonathan Hickman's social commentary comes into play in this book. There's not really a whole lot of it in the earlier pages, but once you get to the librarian, that is when I think he kicks into full gear with social commentary. Now, I know in the last video I talked about Black Wall Street. Now, in this one, I'm talking about something a little bit different, because what the librarian is talking about when he actually steps out of his library, which is, I wanna say, presumably is the same monolith that we saw Nimrod and Silabel in the previous pages, just 1,000 years ahead in time. We don't know yet. We don't really have full-on confirmation, but I'm going to assume that that is exactly the case. And the reason why I say assume is because there's some more information that's about to come to light that I'm going to tell you about here in just a minute. Just bear with me. I'm getting there. You see, the librarian seems to believe in keeping relics of the past, keeping things in such the way that, you know, humanity kept the bones of dinosaurs in museums to remind them of the things that they had come from, the things that they had strived past and overcame, and that you should always have these things to look upon, no matter how evil, no matter how monstrous, no matter how awful those things were, you overcame them and you are now presumably better for it. And he believes that you should keep those things around, keep them in museums, or in this case, what he is referring to is a preserve. And basically what he's going on about is that, yes, we should keep these things isolated so that we can always look upon them, remember what they are, see them for what they are, and hope and pray that we never become those things again, that those things that we used to be, those awful things, never become dominant again. And we notice that inside this preserve are humans. And this is kind of where Hickman's social commentary really kicks into full gear. I mean, I'm gonna go ahead and draw my own personal beliefs on what this is. I'm not saying this is exactly what Hickman is going for, but I mean, he is literally talking about making sure that we are reminded about the atrocities that we have committed throughout all the ages. Yeah, I'm not gonna call on any one specific group of people. I mean, humanity as a whole has done some really awful things to each other. I mean, slavery across the globe has been one of them. Killing people in the name of religion, slaughtering people in the name of nationalism, mass murders and terrorism for reasons that are just ridiculous. Subjugating entire groups of people for reasons that have nothing to do with anything they've done but how they were born. There's a lot that's going on here, and I'm not gonna dig that deep into it because I mean, at this point, I'm pretty sure this video is almost 30 minutes long. But the question I think that everyone's probably wanting to have answered this particular moment is, what the f*** happened to Krakoa? And the thing is, I don't have an answer for that. Krakoa apparently lasted for 30 years. It lasted longer than Genosha and Asteroid M and Utopia or any other type of mutant sanctuary. And after 30 years of prosperity, it fell, because that's what happened to all empires. They never last. They always fail, no matter how malevolent or benevolent they may be. And another thing we learn is that mutant kind as a whole, for the most part, does not live in the Sol system anymore. What is now estimated to being somewhere just under 10,000 mutants live in Shi'ar space, 8,000 of which live on the fringes of Shi'ar space and act as a sort of shield and spear against the incoming Brood attacks, because you remember the Brood is still out there. That is one of the X-Men's oldest cosmic threats. And that's what they do now. They act as an army, a sort of military arm against the Brood. And they do get to live in peace for the most part, but basically think of it as the X-Men on some Starfleet type. Go back to like Star Trek Next Generation, Deep Space Nine. It's like some stuff like that, where basically they are being accosted by like the Borg on the regular, though in this case, it's the Brood. No, not that brood. If it was that Brood, it would be a way more interesting comic. That said, the other 2,000 mutants, they live on the Shi'ar throne world of Shandalar. They're basically used as the Shi'ar Imperial Guard now, with 6 of them being treated as Super Guardians, while another 57 are treated as Sub Guardians. It's even been rumored that Empress Zandra is planning on using mutants as a sympathetic invasion force to take over the Earth, and the mutants themselves are hoping that when this does actually take place, they will be able to be used as the seeds to repopulate the planet. So, I mean, it's getting wild with, you know, the stuff that they're posing as, you know, your future and past, your present, all of it. Just, it's getting wild. Now, the other bit, and this is the last tidbit I'm probably going to leave you here with, because I think that is pretty much everything for the most part, is that when it comes to Earth and the Sol system, because there are no mutants who live on Earth proper, the only mutants who live in the Sol system live on asteroid K, which I'm assuming is where Krakoa has migrated to. Because remember, they were planting these Krakoan flowers all across the place, so they have gateways that can take them anywhere, even into space. And as it stands, only 8 mutants total live in the Sol system. And I can go ahead and tell you right now, one of them is Rasputin, the other one being Cardinal. Now, the other 6 is a bit more of a mystery there, because we know that Wolverine is one of them. We also know that Magneto, or what we can assume is Magneto, though he's wearing a green costume, seems to be more reminiscent of Polaris, but I don't know, maybe it's a son of Magneto's or a descendant of Magneto's. We don't really know 100%. But we also, I got the other one here, may be or may or may not be Gregor Smerdyakov. I'm probably butchering that name, but he sometimes would go by Tree Man or something along those lines. He was basically a mutant who, when he slept, his body would try and turn into like a sentient tree. I'm not saying this is him, but maybe it's a descendant of his. Who knows? The other character who almost kind of looks like Hellspawn from Image Comics, Wildcats. I don't know who that guy is. I'm just gonna be honest with you. I don't know. But Wolverine refers to an old man. He, you know, talking about somebody else who they have to take Rasputin and Cardinal to. Now, is this old man? Is this Charles? Is this somebody else? Like, we don't know who it is. I mean, there's still a lot of characters who have not been introduced yet in the House of X and Powers of 10 comics, because, you know, once again, it's only been one issue for either comic. And once again, I love this issue. This issue is doing exactly what Jonathan Hickman promised. He said that House of X would kind of help redefine how we look at mutants today, and he said that Powers of 10 would make us question the history and the future of mutantkind going forward, and it has done exactly that. He has posed new questions. He has posed new things that can happen. It's one of those things where, like, yeah, we've only had one issue for either comic, so it's really hard to judge the whole story, a 6-parter for both titles, based on the strength of one issue for either of them. But I can say this, I enjoyed both of them a lot. I am hype. I am ready. I am ready for House of X number 2, which is supposed to be the issue that Hickman has said is going to your mind up. But anyways, for better or worse, let me know what you thought about Powers of 10 number 1. Sound off in the comments.
So hey, you made it to the end of the video.
Awesome for you.
If you enjoyed this video, and if you made it this far, I don't see how you didn't, do me a favor, Hulk smash that like button. And if you want to see more awesome videos like this one, make sure you click subscribe so you can become one of Earth's mightiest subscribers, and tap that bell so you know when I post up. Also, feel free to go check out my Patreon, where if you chuck in a buck, you can get early access to most of my videos, up to a week early. And if you have time, make sure you swing by nerd901.com, where you can find more of my content as well as other amazing stuff. Anyways, until next time, I love you 3000 plus ultra!